Hello and welcome to Soteriology 101. Today we're going to do something a little bit different. You are all very used to me going through Calvinism, but what we're going to do today is actually listen to a Lutheran, Dr. Jordan Cooper, talk about Lutheranism from his perspective. I'm just recognizing that I don't think my microphone is on the right microphone here, which is aggravating. But I'm assuming that you're still able to hear me, and so I'm going to continue on here. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to go ahead and play Dr. Cooper speaking about TULIP theology, and you're going to be able to hear him for yourselves. And while we listen to that, I may be able to change my microphone over so that it does sound fine. Okay. It just says it's the wrong microphone on my input for some reason, and so I need to figure out why that is. So I'm glad you can hear me. Okay, well, we're going to start by playing Dr. Jordan Cooper here, and make sure, let me know if you can hear him okay. Hopefully it's coming through all right, and we'll listen to him talk about TULIP, and he explains how TULIP is compared to and contrasted with what he claims is the Lutheran theology. And I'm just going to present this question as to whether what he is saying is contradictory or a paradox. Because he refers to it by the end of it, he just says this is just a paradox, which, by the way, the definition of the word paradox is a seemingly absurd or self-contradictory statement or proposition that, when investigated or explained, may prove to be well-founded or true. Now, he's about to explain it, and so you have to ask yourself, does his explanation take away the seeming absurdity and self-contradictory statements that he's going to be giving? And I honestly don't think that he meets that criteria. I think what he says sounds very contradictory. But again, I admit right up front, I am learning Lutheranism for the first time, and I'm trying to be fair to my brother here. But at the same time, you listen for yourself and you tell me what you think.
A number of people asked me to just do a brief video on the five points of Calvinism and how I approach that as a Lutheran, how the Lutheran tradition generally approaches the five points of Calvinism. So let's start with just an explanation of what the five points are. Now, the five points of Calvinism often are formulated in terms of this phrase TULIP, which we'll go through what each of those points are. But that's really a 20th century invention. And the TULIP formula, while it is helpful in terms of memorization, doesn't always actually word the points of Calvinism very well. But the five points themselves really come out of a debate that occurred between two groups of those coming out of the Reformed branch of the Reformation. And the one was the Remonstrants, or those who were following Jacob Arminius and his teachings about predestination and free will. And the other were those who now are considered Calvinists. And so the Remonstrants wrote up these five points disagreements with those who we consider to be Calvinists, those in the Reformed tradition. And then there was a response from the Synod of Dort, where the five points of Calvinism, as we know them, were laid out, though they weren't using the TULIP formula, but they were a response to the Remonstrants. So what we end up with now is this common way of defining Calvinism through these five points, described as TULIP. So I'm going to go through each of these and just say where, as a Lutheran, I stand, where we take each of these positions, because people often ask, are you a Calvinist or are you an Arminian? And from a Lutheran perspective, we're not Calvinists or Arminians. We don't agree with either side. And that's very confusing for a lot of people because they're thinking just in terms of those categories, and they don't really have a place for thinking in any sense outside of those categories. But we really are outside of those categories. So the five points themselves are really not for us a really even helpful way to arrange discussions of predestination. But because people do so often ask about it, I'm going to go through this just point by point and express where we are on those issues. If you want to get more in depth and see scriptural reasons why we believe the things we do, I have a number of podcasts on each of these points of Calvinism. I've been doing this for my podcast for 7 years at this point. And I began, my very first podcast was a discussion of views on predestination. So there are tons of resources. Go to jordanbcooper.com. If you have any interest, if you want to like delve deeper into these issues scripturally, I would point you there. So let's start with the first. The first point in the TULIP formula is total depravity. Now, total depravity does not mean that man is as evil as possible, but total depravity means that man is depraved. There's an effect of sin in every part of
who we are as human creatures because of original sin. And that means that apart from God's grace, there is no coming to Christ. So
okay, now I want to stop here because, and again, I changed my microphone just now, so hopefully it still sounds okay. And everybody's saying it sounded all right, so I'm glad for that. But if that's changed, let me know. What I would like to really focus on here on the total depravity part is he does say it's what we hear most Calvinists say is total depravity doesn't mean you're as bad as you could be, but apparently it does mean you're as blind as you could be. In other words, like I've said before, it seems to be as if Calvinists and maybe even Lutherans in this perspective is saying that the hands aren't doing as bad of deeds as they could be doing. They're not always out there stealing or murdering or doing really bad things. Now they obviously could become that way if they continue in the road of sin. But so people aren't born with their hands doing as bad as they could, but apparently they are as blind as they could be from birth. They're as deaf as they could be from birth. Now, if the Calvinist just consistently, or even the Lutheran here, anybody who affirms total inability, even I guess classical Arminians, if they affirm true total moral inability from birth as the Calvinist defines it, then why is there in the insistence on not just applying the same principle you do to the hands as you would to the eyes or to the ears? So in the same way you would say they're not doing as bad as they could, they're also not as blind as they could be. In other words, they're not as hardened as they could be. They're not as calloused as they could be. Their conscience is not as seared as it could be, meaning that they still have the capacity to respond to God's grace. Now, this is another important distinction between Dr. Cooper and myself, is that he seems to, at least later in this video, affirm that the gospel is a means of grace. And yet here he says we can't reply positively to the gospel. Otherwise, that would be the dreaded boogeyman of semi-Pelagianism, which he's already denounced us for. And so on the one hand, he says we need God's grace in order to respond. But yet, for some reason, he just denies that the gospel is a sufficient work of divine grace. And I just have to say chapter verse, where does the Bible teach this? I understand that you don't want to be labeled a semi-Pelagian. So, you know, got to go to whatever means necessary to make sure you don't get that label slapped on you. But where's your biblical defense for this? Because the Bible seems to suggest and to teach that if a person ignores the word of God, as Hebrews 3 and 4 warns, when you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts, which seems to suggest that you have something to do with that. And so if you hear his voice, and you close your eyes, as Acts 28, verse 27 and 28 talks about, the hardened ones, those who have become ever seeing and never perceiving, ever hearing and never understanding. That's not a condition from birth, according to Paul. It's something they have become because they close their eyes. Otherwise, he says, they might see, hear, understand, and turn, and I would heal them. Therefore, I take the message to the Gentiles, and they'll listen. So he's contrasting the Jews and the Gentiles. You could say that, using the hand analogy again, The Gentiles of that day were much more immoral. They were doing more bad things with their hands. They were stealing as tax collectors. They were conducting orgies and prostitution and all these kinds of things. In other words, the Jews of that day were, their hands were morally speaking a lot cleaner than the Gentiles' hands. So what's he comparing? He's not comparing their hands. He's comparing their eyes. You are ever seeing but not perceiving. In other words, you can't receive the Messiah. Jesus is your Messiah because you have grown calloused. You're an old wineskin that can't take new wine. Your conscience has become seared. Why? Because you closed your eyes, not because of a condition you were born in that you inherited from Adam. There's no mention of that in this text or really any other text with regard to why people are unable to see, hear, turn, and repent in light of the grace of the gospel. This is really what I want to push back on. From my friends in the Lutheran camp or from the Arminian, more classical Arminian camp, is where in the scripture does it teach that fallen people are morally or spiritually incapable of responding to God's life-giving truth, calling them to reconciliation from that fallen condition? Now, what you're going to hear him go on to talk about is that what he would rather talk about is the bondage of the will. So listen to what he says about that, because obviously a Lutheran would want to emphasize especially that aspect, because the bondage of the will was really the Luther's book and Luther's focus was on the bondage of the will. But as you listen to this, ask yourself the question, does being in bondage to sin equal the moral incapacity to confess that you're in bondage when approached with the law and the gospel? Let me say that again and let it sink in. drop your presuppositions for just a minute, back away and just listen to the question. Is proof that you are in bondage to sin proof that you can't confess that bondage in faith and trust in the one who is showing you how to escape your bondage? The analogy we've used before is that of an alcoholic. Is an alcoholic in bondage to alcohol? Absolutely. He is addicted to alcohol. For all practical purposes, we'll just say he cannot stop drinking alcohol on his own, no matter what. He is addicted, addicted, addicted. Okay. Even if we were to establish that this person was born addicted to alcohol, which is obviously problematic, you wouldn't want to argue that, but let's just say for the sake of argument, he's born addicted to alcohol. Okay. Maybe he just was born because it was in the blood of his mother and he was just born addicted to alcohol. And for whatever reason, they put it in the bottle and he just drank alcohol his entire life growing up. And he is just born and raised on alcohol. Okay. And he is an alcoholic through and through. Now, the law comes. The law would be that which reveals his addiction, right? It would show his need. And so let's say that's in the form of an intervention for our analogy. Somebody comes to a group of people come to him and says, hey, you're an alcoholic. It's destroying your life. You can't stop drinking and it's causing you to do things that are violent and mean and you've got to do something about your alcoholism. Now he's been intervened. He's been confronted in his alcoholism. Now, does he have the capacity to confess that he's an alcoholic and check himself into the rehab facility? They've already paid the cost for it. The ticket's right there. You just got to walk in the door. Can he do that? Or does his alcoholism mean that he cannot accept their help even when it's graciously offered to them? Because ultimately, that's what it seems like they're saying. They're saying that because he's an alcoholic, he can't confess that he's an alcoholic and trust them whenever they come to him and confront him and walk into the rehab facility so as to accept the help of professionals. He can't do that because of his alcoholism. That doesn't compute. It doesn't make sense. Proving that somebody is addicted to alcohol does not prove they're incapable of confessing that fact and checking into a rehab facility when confronted. Okay, so what you have to do as a Lutheran or an Arminian or any other group of people, what you need to do is you need to demonstrate for me in a coherent way how proof that we are addicted to sin means, therefore, we are incapable, morally speaking, we are incapable, born incapable, by God's decree, mind you, we're born incapable of confessing that we're addicted to sin and trusting in the one, the professional, if you will, to help us, the rehab facility, who is Christ. He is the rehab facility. He's the only one who can rehab us. He's the only one who can sanctify us. He's the only one who can cleanse us. He's the only one who can wash us. So proof that we are addicted to sin, you have to show me biblically and convince me, show me biblically how being addicted to sin proves that we can't recognize that when the schoolmaster, the tutor is sent by God for the law and the gracious gospel calling us to reconciliation comes to us as a grace sent, Holy Spirit wrought, inspired, supernaturally inspired through the apostles, preserved for us in the scriptures. When that's brought to us by circumstances that, yes, I believe the Holy Spirit is bringing into the lives of people through dreams and all kinds of means that God uses to make the truth of who he is known to us. He uses all kinds of means. The gospel is obviously the primary, but he uses all kinds of means to make sure we hear the gospel and to make sure we understand the gospel. I'm not trying to deny, by the way, for those that are wondering, that the Holy Spirit might use other means beside the preaching of the word or the reading of the scriptures. I'm simply arguing that the preaching of the word and the reading of the scriptures are sufficient to do what the Bible says they are meant to do, and that God can use any means to draw people to himself, to mercifully let us know where the truth is. And so I'm just asking men like Jordan Cooper and others who maintain, quote-unquote, total inability from birth, that being in bondage to sin or being addicted to sin somehow equals the moral incapacity to confess our bondage and put our trust in the one who is offering to set us free. Truth will set you free, the Bible says. Doesn't say secret work of regeneration will set you free, okay? This truth will set you free, and you're responsible for what you do with truth. You can suppress the truth, or you can accept truth. If you accept the truth, it will set you free. If you suppress the truth, what will happen to you? You'll grow hardened to that truth. You'll grow callous to that truth. The longer you suppress it, the more you push it down, the less you'll be able to hear, the less you'll be able to see, the less you'll be able to understand, and the more hardened in your conscience will become seared, and you will grow more and more defiled in your not only seeing and hearing, but in your doing, your actions. And so if you just don't jump to the quote-unquote Calvinistic conclusion of total moral inability, or the westernized version of that that really originated in Augustine's thesis, then if you don't jump to that and you keep the traditional view of the earliest church fathers, which was that we did have the ability to accept or reject the proffered grace of God through the gospel, that the scriptures were sufficient to lead you to salvation, as Paul says to Timothy, that you've known the scriptures from infancy, which are able to make you wise unto salvation, Paul said. Now, either you believe that or you don't. Either the scriptures are able to make you wise unto salvation or they're not. And on this particular view of total inability, they're not able to do that, not without some effectual work or some kind of irresistible work of grace, which, by the way, Jordan Cooper doesn't hold to, which makes this really interesting. And when I was listening to this, I had to listen to it twice just to try to figure out what he's trying to say. And it really just sounds to me, and again, I'm still learning. I'm willing to have Jordan on. I've invited him several times to come onto the program. I'm willing to talk through this with him. But it really sounds like he's saying A is true, but not A is also true. And that's a paradox, and we just don't get it. And we'll find out in heaven how it is that A is true and not A is also true. That's what it comes across to me as. You be the judge for yourself. Here's what he goes on to say about total depravity.
In that phraseology, Lutherans would certainly agree. We don't usually use the phrase total depravity. I think the phrase itself just sounds a little confusing because it seems to get across the idea, at least just at first glance, that we are as evil as possible, which is not the case. There is such a thing as civic righteousness. Even apart from faith, there is a civic good that an unbeliever can do, though it is not truly done in faith, so therefore it is not good before God. But just in the external world, there are things that are positive, impacts that are positive that humans can do. So we would use the phrase, the bondage of the will, right? That's the phrase that Martin Luther uses, his famous work, that the will is bound to sin, so that the human creature cannot free themselves from their sinful condition.
Okay, so you can't free yourself from your sinful condition. Can you confess that you're in that sinful condition and trust in him to free you? That's the question. So we'll agree with your statement, especially for the sake of the argument. But I don't think provisionism would contradict or disagree with your basic premise there, that sinners sin and that we're enslaved to sin due to the environment and our nature, if you will, or our fallen capacity, or our being cast out of the garden. We're separated from God and his righteousness and his goodness. And because of that, we are sinners and we will inevitably fall into sin. And because of that, inevitably be addicted to our sinful ways. And therefore we are in bondage to sin. Now the question is, can we confess that fact in light of the grace brought to us, the truth of the law and the gospel brought to us by gracious means? That's the question. I have not heard a Calvinist, Arminian, or Lutheran who affirms total inability address that issue, at least a sufficient way for me to understand. And maybe I'm just not the sharpest knife in the tool shed and I just can't get it. But I've been studying this my entire adult life and I've read a lot of material on the subject and I'm trying to understand. I'm not, y'all, you guys know me. I'm willing to learn. I'm willing to admit when I'm wrong about something. I'm willing to have Jordan onto the program and talk through these things. I'm honestly trying to understand how bondage to the will, slavery to sin, equals a moral innate incapacity to confess that fact when grace comes, when God's grace comes through the gospel. The double-edged sword of the word of God comes to us, confronts us. Why is that insufficient for us to respond to it? On what basis? On the basis of you're afraid to be called a semi-Pelagian? Because if that's it, then tough. That's not going to work for me because I don't care what you call me. I want to know what the word of God says. I can do no other, to quote somebody you all know. Here I stand, I can do no other.
Now, when we're talking about the bondage of the will, this isn't a general statement about the nature of the human will just as a whole, which oftentimes, if you look at someone like Jonathan Edwards and the way that he expresses this in his book, The Freedom of the Will, this is a more general idea that has to do with just the will as a whole. But we're not really talking about that when we talk about the bondage of the will. This is specifically the human creature in relation to sin. What is the effect of sin on the will? And the question is, can we, apart from God's grace, in our sinful nature, choose that which is spiritually good, and the answer scripturally to that.
So did you hear that statement? Can we, and without God's grace, can we without God's grace? And that's the important part here, because this is kind of where we're getting back and forth on the Twitter stuff, is that whenever I push Dr. Cooper on this particular issue, I try to ask him, is the proclamation of God's grace through the gospel, is that grace? Is that supernatural grace? Is the inspiration of scripture supernatural? I would think he would have to say yes, but he keeps accusing me of redefining grace. But listen, as we get to irresistible grace, he gets to the eye of irresistible grace, and he actually comes right out and says the gospel is a means of grace, just like we do. And so it's really strange for me listening to this. It's kind of like I'm in a Twilight Zone episode or something, because he says things that sound very Calvinistic in one portion of this, and then he goes on a little bit later and he says something exactly the way I would say it. And I'm just going, so it's like I'm going no and then amen and then no and amen, and it's just back and forth. It's really, really strange. But let me back up just a second and listen to what he said.
Sinful nature, choose that which is spiritually good, and the answer scripturally on the will. And the question is, can we, apart from God's grace?
Okay, did you hear that? Can we, apart from God's grace? And if that's all you say, then I would say, no, we can't do anything apart from God's grace, okay? Because we need, how will we believe in one whom we have not heard? Romans 10, 14. How would you come to him unless he draws us? John 6, 44. We need his drawing. We need his invitation. We need his grace. We need the light. The light that which enlightens all men in John 1, 9. We need the light to see. Otherwise, we're in darkness without the light. We need the light, okay? So yes, we need his grace. The question is, what do you define as grace? Because I define light as grace. I define truth, the word, the double-edged sword, I define that as grace. Do you? Because whenever we're talking about the Semi-Pelagian thing over on the side, you keep saying, oh, well, you keep calling the gospel. You redefine grace as to include the gospel proclamation. Why in the world would you not include grace with the gospel? Why wouldn't you say that the gospel is God's gracious means of making himself known and calling us to repentance and faith? I've written these things, John says, so that you may believe, and that by believing you have life in his name. What is that if not grace? This is where it's really, really baffling. And somebody's, I don't see where it is because I just saw Nathan's tweet here. It says, how's Leighton playing word games with grace? And I'm not sure who you're replying to, Nathan, but and it's probably scrolling by and I've just missed it. I would like to know that too. How am I playing word games with grace? Okay. Here's Jay Dean. Grace to Dr. Flowers is an empty word. It's intellectual knowledge. Okay. Is that what you think? Because I know you would have to affirm that knowledge is necessary. How will they believe in one whom they don't know? I mean, you got to be called, you got to know something. So knowledge is a part of it. Yes. They're not denying that knowledge is there. But how is grace an empty word? If revelation is, if light is, if truth is gracious, graciously brought to us, revelation's gracious, isn't it? Does God have to send the inspired word through apostles? No, it's obviously a gracious thing that he does that. So how is that an empty word with me simply because I believe that God, by means of revelation, makes himself known sufficiently for us to respond to it? And this is another thing that's it's kind of baffling to me how people will treat those who affirm total inability, an invention of the fifth century by Augustine, who was a former Manichaean, and we don't see it in any of the early church writings until Augustine. And the only other time we see it is in Gnosticism, which teaches for a different reason that all people are born in what? A moral incapacitated state because flesh is evil. And there was a war that happened between the two, good God and the bad God. But that's the only other place we see it in the first 300 to 400 years, is this total moral inability is from the Manichaeans and Gnostics. We don't see this moral inability. And by the way, that's not my conclusion. That's the conclusion of Reformed historians like Bavinck and Bettner and others that we've read from dozens of times on the other programs. So I'm trying to get to the bottom of this to say, okay, why do you treat those who believe that God graciously maintains within us the ability to respond because we're created in his image, and therefore we're able as I think C.S. Lewis argues, that we have, in a sense, the God-shaped hole within us, that we have a conscience. And therefore, we maintain, even despite the fall, we maintain this capacity by God's design. In other words, we're not trying to say that we go out into the tool shed and we build us a free will, okay? And so we like get a hammer out and we build us a little free will to stick in there, okay? This is an ability from God. What do we have that's not from God? Is that from God? Is that breath that I just took, is that from God? Yes, it's from, all we have is from God, okay? All we have is from God. Everything is from the Father. So on one view, the Arminian, traditional Arminian view, they're saying that everybody lost this capacity because of the fall, and then God gives it back to every single person at some point, which I think is a Lutheran perspective too. That may be what objective justification is about, if I understand it correctly, is that pretty much everything that was lost is regained, is given back to us. And on our view, we just say, no, he graciously, if you will, graciously allowed us to maintain the ability to respond to him. Just because you're cast out of the garden doesn't mean you can't respond to him when he comes to you outside the garden to speak to you or to call you or to give you light or truth. And so what we're trying to establish is that the concept or the idea that we have lost the capacity to respond to God himself is never established in the pages of Scripture, and therefore there's no reason for us to establish that. Instead, we have to, I think, look back to where the Scriptures go through these things and understand, yeah, we can grow calloused and hardened and blinded and deaf if we continue to avoid the truth and the light of God's Word and continue to ignore it. But there's nothing in the Bible that says you're born already like that, as far as I can tell, at least. And I'm glad to, you know, hear it out, but I haven't heard it yet.
Ace, in our sinful nature, choose that which is spiritually good. And the answer scripturally to that is no. We have other distinctions, you know, in the Augsburg Confession, for example, Melanchthon comes up with this distinction that we don't have free will in terms of things above us, right? Spiritual things, but we do have free will in terms of things below us. Like, you know, I have the free will to decide what breakfast cereal I'm going to eat. So we're not talking about just this will in a general sense, but when we're speaking about the lack of.
So it sounds like by that statement, he does not affirm compatibilism as we understand it, because even quote unquote, the sovereign decree of God would ultimately be that which causally determines what breakfast cereal he chooses. And they would claim it's still free because he's doing what he wants to do. He's choosing the Kellogg's brand cereal because he wants to. And he wants to do that because his nature and the circumstances have been decreed by God in such a way that he would have only chose that given those circumstances in his nature. And therefore, that's compatibilism defined by Bing-Yong and other leading compatibilistic Calvinists. Now, he's not primarily a philosopher, so I'm not sure where he stands on compatibilism, but it sounds like if he's saying that free means you have the capacity to choose between Fruit Loops and Bran Flakes, then that's libertarian freedom, meaning that you surely have nothing about your nature or a sovereign decree that is causally determining which cereal box you're going to eat from that morning. And again, I would have to push him in particular as to where he stands on compatibilism versus libertarian free will, but that's really not the point of the discussion today, at least.
Free will. This is the question of, are we able to do anything spiritually good apart from grace? And the answer unambiguously would be no. So we agree with the point of total depravity, but we wouldn't really use that particular phrase.
Okay, just trying to engage with some of the side chat here. And again, I imagine Lutheranism is probably a lot like any other group, is that it's not monolithic. They're not all going to say the same exact things. But Gray Knight says, Leighton is wrong. Lutherans don't believe we are totally incapable of responding positively to God. We believe we are corrupt enough that we could never save ourselves on our own. Okay, well, nobody's arguing, Gray, that we can save ourselves on our own. Okay. What we're arguing is, can we respond to the invitation to salvation so as to be saved by God? That's the difference. Nobody's saying that you save yourself. What we're saying is, can you respond to the invitation of God so as to be saved by him? Okay. Just like with the analogy of the addict, he can't stop drinking on his own. He has to go into the rehab facility in order to stop drinking. So he's not, quote unquote, getting rid of alcoholism or getting rid of the addiction on his own. He is checking himself into the rehab facility so as to gain the help from somebody else that he needs. In the same way, the gospel appeal is for all to come to be reconciled, to be saved. And if we submit to him, if we come to him, if we come out of our pigsty and return home, then he is the one who saves us. He is the one wholly and completely, 100% salvation is of God. But you are 100% responsible for whether you receive or reject his appeal, his offer of grace. And so, again, hopefully that clarifies the two positions. And I'm not sure if that helps to at least explain things. And just for the time's sake, I'm going to continue with Dr. Cooper's video. I know there's some other things in the side chat I'd like to deal with, but we won't ever get through the whole video if we don't.
And the second point of TULIP is the U, unconditional election. Now, on this question of unconditional election, we would certainly say that election is unconditional, right? So just to summarize what this is saying is the idea that when God elects someone into salvation, there is nothing in the person that is a cause of their election. So God is not electing somebody because he foresees anything within them, whether that is their good works or whether he foresees that they will believe. But God's election is unconditional. There are no conditions attached to why God chooses those he does for salvation, but it's a completely free act of grace. So we would affirm that, that aspect of unconditional election. But when you're talking about unconditional election within Calvinism, this is formulated a little differently because there are two sides of this. On the one hand, there is an unconditional election unto salvation. And then on the other hand, there is a decision to pass over others and leave them in their sin. And so there is no grace offered to others. Now, we can speak about things like common grace, but there is no saving grace that is intended by God, not just offered in the proclamation of the gospel in terms of the free offer of the gospel, but there is no intention of God to convert the non-elect. And so there is this negative aspect, which is reprobation. Now, there are different ways that Calvinists formulate this double aspect of predestination, this negative aspect of it. But in general, we would agree with the positive aspect of unconditional election. But then where Calvinists go in terms of the implications of what that means for those who are not elect, we would not go there on those on that view.
Okay. And so no real explanation is given to how you square that circle. But ultimately, what you have is God unconditionally electing who he is going to save. Okay. But on the other side of that, he is not therefore, you can't say that on the other side of that, therefore, everyone who is quote unquote not unconditionally elected is therefore destined for reprobation or intended by God to be reprobated or to be condemned. How do you square that circle? If I've got 10 people in the room, all of which by my decision are in a fallen condition, in a disabled condition from birth due to reasons beyond their control, and I choose for reasons only known to me, nothing about the individual 10 people, if I choose three of them and I change their hearts and their minds to make them want to do what I need them to do in order to save them, i.e. believe, then how am I not, by implication, if nothing else, saying to the other seven people, to hell with you? You see what I'm saying? I mean, I have the capacity to give whatever grace it is that or unconditionally elect all 10 of them if I want to and cause them in whatever ways to believe in the truth or to come, but I choose not to. I only unconditionally choose the three that end up believing and trusting. And this is why I think I agree with Calvin on this point, is that it's a childish refuge to try to deny the doctrine of reprobation while maintaining the doctrine of unconditional election from the Calvinistic perspective. Now, to be clear on this point, we would affirm that election is unconditional with regard to the condition of meritorious works. And that's what we believe Paul and the other apostles people are talking about, the scriptures authors are talking about, is that God doesn't elect anyone or any nation on the basis of their merit or their works. In other words, person's not elected based upon the morality. So, for example, King David. I can think of probably a lot more people who are more moral than King David, but God still elected him for what he uses him for and chooses him for, right? The nation of Israel, Deuteronomy 7:7. I didn't choose them because you're a great nation or you're more impressive. Matter of fact, you're small in number. God has a tendency to choose weak vessels to bring about his purposes. So if Gideon's army is too big, what does he do? He pares it down and makes it small first before he uses it for his service. Well, God chooses weak things to bring about his purposes. Why? So that he gets the glory for what they accomplish. So if there's any condition for God's election of things, it's for their weakness. It's for their lack of qualifications, not for their abundance in qualifications. God chooses the weak to shame the wise. So there is a condition there that's to be weak. Okay. God chooses to save the humble and bring low those eyes who are haughty. Psalm 18:27. There's a condition there. Humility, weakness. The condition for God's choosing is that you don't meet the qualifications and that you confess that you don't meet the qualifications. That's ultimately the qualification, is that you don't meet the qualifications and you admit it. You confess that fact. And so the pushback that we would have with the concept of unconditional election is to say, yes, we agree. It's not conditioned upon your merit or your worth. That doesn't mean it's not conditioned upon faith. That's what the good news is all about. Is it? No, yeah, no one can work their way to heaven. All have fallen short, but there's good news. Trust in him. Trust in Christ. You can't earn it through faith, and you can't earn it through works. So what's your only hope? Faith. And what the Calvinist, and I guess by default here, the Lutherans, depending on where they land on this, is that if you can't merit the righteousness through the law, then also that means you can't trust in the one who merited for us on our behalf. You can't have faith in him. It's just not possible unless he's unconditionally elected you and somehow graces you in an irresistible way or just in a prevenient way. That's what he's about to get into when he gets into the I, which is really where it gets convoluting and difficult to follow, because it does sound very contradictory, at least as far as I can tell. So we would say, yes, there is an unconditional aspect of election. God didn't choose the nation of Israel because they merited it or because they're more worthy. God doesn't choose to save believers because of a merit, because we don't believe faith is meritorious. Okay, believing and trusting in the merit of Christ is not itself meritorious. And so, at least the way Paul taught it anyway. And so therefore, yes, it's unconditional upon the merit or worth or value of any individual, but it is conditioned upon faith in Christ, by grace through faith in Christ. And that is what is required, is that you believe and trust in him. That is the condition for salvation.
And now we get to the third point of Calvinism. And this is where the differences really show themselves most clearly. And that is the idea of a limited atonement. Now, limited atonement sometimes is referred to as particular redemption. It's the idea that in the cross of Christ, Jesus dies for a particular people. He dies for the elect people of God and secures their salvation necessarily on the cross, but he does not die for those who are not elect. Now, again, there are differences of opinion in terms of how this works out within Calvinism. And there are people who call themselves four-point Calvinists or Emeraldians or hypothetical universalists or all these other positions within the Reformed tradition. But it is this point of limited atonement that is the most obviously differentiates the Lutheran approach from that of Calvinism. So we would reject the notion that Jesus died only for a specific people, and we would contend that God's grace is for all. Jesus died for all. The Father desires the salvation of all, and the Holy Spirit works through the means of grace.
Okay, so God desires the salvation of all, but he unconditionally elected a few. Again, this is where the brain just kind of go, oh, I'm trying to understand this. And maybe they would appeal to a mystery on that or a paradox on that and say, well, that's why it's divine. It's just incomprehensible. It's supposed to make your brain blow up. And I'm just saying, well, if you don't misinterpret the Calvinistic texts that are used as proof texts for unconditional election to mean unconditioned upon faith as well as meritorious works, then you don't have that problem. If you don't adopt the concept and idea that we're born morally incapable of confessing our bondage when confronted with the grace of God, then you don't have this quandary. You don't have this paradox to even contend with. If you aren't so scared of being labeled a semi-Pelagian so as to adopt an actual biblical view, then you don't really have the paradox or mystery or this quandary to adopt. But that's why I'm pushing back on it. If people are born with an incapacity to believe and trust the gospel when it comes to them, and only certain people are unconditionally elected before the foundation of the world for salvation, and the others aren't, And then you also say that God genuinely desires and pays for, brings atonement for all men. Do you not see how this seems not just paradoxical, but contradictory? You be the judge. I mean, you have to decide for yourself what that means.
Every time those means of grace are administered and he works to convert the one who is hearing or receiving the means of grace. So there is this threefold universalism of the Father, Son, and Spirit, not in the sense that all are saved, but there is a real desire and work of the three persons of the Holy Trinity so that God's desire and design is for all ultimately to be saved. And I would point to a number of passages in Scripture that deal with this issue of the extent of the atonement. And I think that repeatedly it is very clear in Scripture that Jesus did indeed die for all people, and it is God's ultimate will for all to be saved. So then the fourth point of Calvinism is irresistible grace. Now, again, here is where we're going to see a strong disagreement between the Lutheran tradition and that of Calvinism. So within the Lutheran tradition, it's said that grace is indeed resistible. I mean, we see this, you know, the sermon in Acts at Pentecost, why are you always resisting the Holy Spirit? And we see this kind of language used throughout Scripture, that God's grace is universal, not all are saved, therefore people resist God's grace. So, and it's not that God couldn't make his grace irresistible. God certainly can.
And the way a Calvinist would push back against that, and they would say, well, that's what total inability is all about, is that we by nature would always resist God's grace unless he steps in with an effectual kind of grace, the irresistible kind, the effectual calling kind. And so the way a Calvinist would answer you, Dr. Cooper, is to say, yes, we agree with Acts 7:51 and others that talk about the resistance. You always resist the Holy Spirit because that's the condition of everybody from birth, which you already acknowledged in your first one, the T, for fear of becoming a semi-Pelagian, I guess. So you've already affirmed what the Calvinist is saying when he says that everybody by nature resists the grace of God. And now you're coming along and arguing against the T that you already affirmed, which again is why the Calvinist would call you just completely inconsistent.
Could. But God has chosen to work through means that are resistible. He has chosen to work through the means of grace. So as God offers his grace and brings his grace through the means of grace, there is a real possibility that individuals, people, will resist that grace. And this is what happens every time someone hears the gospel and rejects it. They are resisting God's grace, as God's grace is present in.
Did y'all hear that? Every time somebody hears the gospel and resists it, they are resisting God's grace. Because there's grace in the gospel. That does that not sound like what we believe? This is where I was kind of like going, oh my gosh, it's like, it's just, it, the quandary there is just, let me back up and make sure you get it, okay?
Resist that grace. And this is what happens every time someone hears the gospel and rejects it. They are resisting God's grace, as God's grace is present in his word and sacrament. God's grace is always present through the means of grace.
God's grace is always present through his means of grace. Does that not sound like exactly what I talk about? Now, he may mean it in a different way through his sacramental views or whatever else that he holds to. I'm not sure of all the Lutheran doctrines regarding this particular point. But I do believe that the gospel is a grace of God, that God works by means of the gospel. That is a means of grace, and it's a sufficient means of grace. In other words, when I say sufficient, I don't mean effectual. That's why sometimes Calvinists mistakenly use the word sufficient as if it means effectual. Sufficient means it is enough to do what it's meant to do. Okay. So if it's sufficient, that means it's enough to allow for or to present the offer of salvation to the point that a lost person is able to respond to it positively or negatively, or whatever they choose, by their own freedom of the will. Okay. And so either you believe that the gospel grace that you just spoke of is sufficient, or you don't. You could say it's hypothetically sufficient, like you talked about with the atonement, which is what some Calvinistic groups do, which say, well, yeah, hypothetically it's sufficient if God wanted it to be. Okay, what does that even mean? What we're trying to say is, yes, it's sufficient to do what the Bible says it was meant to do. So if the Bible says these things were written so that you may believe, then silly us, we think that they're sufficient for people to believe them, unless we're told otherwise. And the only reason they wouldn't be sufficient to be believed is if somebody has grown dull. Their hearts have grown callous. They've closed their eyes. Then they wouldn't be able to see, hear, understand, and turn, just like Paul says. And so unless a person grows into that condition, there's no reason to assume that condition is innate from birth, unless the Bible says it's an innate condition from birth. What I suspect will happen, though, is the Lutheran will do the same thing the Calvinist does and quote a bunch of verses that we agree with about the sinfulness of man and about how depraved and bondage they are to sin. And we'll just go, amen, amen, amen. We agree with that. But how does that prove that men are therefore incapable of confessing that fact in light of the grace, the light, the truth brought by God himself through supernatural means, no less? That's what we're trying to get to.
Those are the means that the Holy Spirit has chosen to work through. And so every time someone hears the gospel or receives the sacraments and rejects it, they are indeed resisting God's grace. So we would say that God's grace is universal and it is.
So how I would love Jordan to explain to me, how is it that I have redefined grace, like he's accusing me in this semi-Pelagian controversy that we're having on Twitter back and forth. And he keeps accusing me, well, you've just redefined grace to mean something different than what they meant it by. You just define grace exactly the way I do, in the sense that the means of grace, God bringing the truth, that we can resist that truth, we can resist the gospel, which is a means of grace that God brings. How is it that I've redefined grace when you seem to be defining it, at least when you're talking about this particular subject, you seem to be defining it the same way I do?
So that would be a major point of disagreement between us and those who hold to the Calvinist position on election. And then we have the fifth point, which is the perseverance of the saints. Now, here we've got, and this is the thing, a lot of these points, we have agreements and disagreements. And this is true about just about all of them, except limited atonement's pretty clear that there's no agreement, and total depravity is pretty clear that there is pretty much agreement on that point. But with all of the others, there's kind of nuances. It's a yes and no answer. And so perseverance is the same way. So we believe that God's grace is resistible, and that means that God's grace is resistible even in the life of the believer. So there is the possibility that one can be regenerated and then reject the grace of God and indeed fall away from the faith even finally. And so that there is a possibility of rejection of Christ and rejection of the Spirit and rejection of the work of God. And I would just point to a number of scripture passages that speak in that way. I mean, it's all over. Look at the book of Hebrews, but not just there. It's all over the New Testament and in the Old Testament as well. So we see that there is a real possibility of apostasy. In other words, if you are saved, if you are regenerate, that doesn't mean that you will necessarily persevere to the end. But there are points of this idea of perseverance of the saints that we would affirm. So, for example, we would say that those who are elect will inevitably be saved. Those who are elect will inevitably convert, and they will inevitably persevere.
Okay. Trying to hold my... Okay. Those unconditionally elected will inevitably be saved, but we still believe you can fall away. How is that not A equals not A? Yeah, we believe that, you know, once you're saved, you can resist the grace and you can lose your salvation. But we believe that those unconditionally elected, they will inevitably stay and not fall away and will be converted and will be saved. A is true. Yeah, A is true. Yeah, but not A is also true. How is that not just blatantly contradictory? I just don't get it. I mean, I am baffled. And maybe this is why I've heard Calvinists several times. I've heard James White talk about this, and I'm not trying to say James White is an authority on Lutheranism any more so than he's an authority on provisionism for that matter. But I've heard him talk about how confounding and confusing and contradictory Lutheranism is. And I see why he says that. I see why Calvin says that about those who say these kinds of things. And I'm not trying to pit Calvinists against Lutherans here. Sometimes they try to pit Calvinists against provisionists because what is the old saying? A friend of an enemy of your friend is a friend of your enemy, or something of that nature. Anyway, people like to join in with whoever. I've heard so many Calvinists online on Twitter all of a sudden like high five and glad handing Jordan Cooper because he's coming after me. And I'm just like going, guys, yeah. I would love to hear you have a discussion with Jordan Cooper because he doesn't believe hardly anything you guys believe. And yet, yes, yeah, oh yeah, well, he's joining with us and not agreeing with you. So we're going to glad hand him and backslap him when he's not agreeing with you. Okay, well, fine. I mean, if that's what you feel good about, but is his option better for you? Is this what you are adopting? Because it sounds like blatant contradictions to me.
If you're in that faith, we would also say that if one does persevere, that perseverance is a gift of God. It's not that we preserve ourselves in the faith. It's not that you are converted and now it's up to you to keep yourself in the faith. No, God is the one who keeps you in the faith. God continues to work through the means of grace. We can reject.
God keeps you in the faith if you're unconditionally elected, but you can resist his grace and fall away. But you inevitably will not do that if you're unconditionally elected. But you can, if you do, you will. But if you don't, he won't. I've listened to this. This is my third time to listen to this, and I'm trying to get my brain around it without it just being just blatant contradiction. And I thought the first time I was listening to it, I thought maybe I'm just missing something, but then hear how he concludes. And you'll see, he kind of pretty much just says, yeah, this is contradictory.
And walk away from that. But it is indeed God that is the one persevering us. It is God who is the one who is keeping us in the faith. So we can't take any credit for that, in other words. So we would agree with that aspect of perseverance. But in terms of the question of, are there those who are regenerate and do fall away? We would say unambiguously, again, we would say, yes, scripture is clear on that question. Whereas a Calvinist would disagree on that point. So this leaves.
So the regenerate, the elect that become regenerate will inevitably be saved, but the regenerate can resist and walk away. A and not A are true.
Puts us in a position that's very different from both Calvinism and Arminianism. And sometimes this has been summarized by the question, why are some saved and others not saved? And it's said that Calvinism and Arminianism both have one single answer.
Listen.
That they each give to those two different questions. So if you ask a Calvinist, why are some saved and not others? The answer would be God or God's decree, right? God decrees to save some. He decrees to pass over others and leave them in their sin. If you ask an Arminian, why are some saved and not others? The answer to the question will be man or the human will, right? Some are saved because they have chosen to accept Christ. They have chosen to be Christians, and others are not.
Well, what does Paul say? They perish because they refuse to love the truth so as to be saved. So that would, and I'm assuming he would put me in the Arminian camp, because we would ultimately say that those who perish, perish not because of a lack of atonement. They don't perish because God didn't want them. They perish because they have refused the truth so as to be saved. So that's Paul's words. They perish because they refuse the truth so as to be saved, or they resist the truth so as to be saved. So what's wrong with that? What's wrong with saying the provision is made for all, but only benefits those who look to it in faith? If you don't think faith is meritorious, which we don't, then it's not being saved by merit or works. It's not something you're earning, because faith doesn't earn anything. God didn't owe people who believe salvation. That's why we need the imputed righteousness of Christ. And this is what we pointed out a dozen times. But when it says Abraham believed and it was credited to him as righteousness, it doesn't say Abraham earned his righteousness by believing. What's it saying? It's saying God graciously imputes the righteousness of Christ onto the account of those who believe. Belief in and of itself doesn't mean it's a filthy rag without the atoning work of Christ. I think of the publican in the story of the Pharisee who's praying on the street corner. Lord, I'm, you know, thank you, God, that I'm, you know, not a woman and a slave and all those bad things that those other people are. Thank you for making me who I am and all these kinds of, you know, very prideful kind of prayer. And then there's the Gentile tax collector who's, he won't even look up to heaven. He's just such ashamed of himself and his sin. And he just cries out for mercy. Just says, God, I can't do this. I don't know. I can't even look to you. I am so unworthy. And what is Jesus' conclusion from that parable? This one, rather than the other, walked home justified. So there's a justification text. It's soteriological by far. Does that mean that the publican who bowed his head and cried out in shame and humility, does that mean he earned his salvation by doing that? No. Does it mean that God effectually caused him to do that? Even Jordan Cooper doesn't say that. So what does it mean? It means that God graciously chose to impute 100% God's choice, one monergistically, if you will. He chooses to give that publican grace. He chooses to impute the righteousness of Christ. So it's not that he's righteous because he's humble. It's that God chooses to impute the righteousness of Christ onto him. He chooses to do that. To those who confess they can't do it himself, he chooses to give them the righteousness of Christ. I know people don't like when I use the analogy of the prodigal son on this because they think I overuse it, but It's the perfect example of what we're talking about. Did the son on his journey home, coming home to beg for a job from his dad, did he merit or earn what he was about to get in any way, shape, or form? No. If anything, he deserved to be punished, probably stoned, for what he did to his father and squandering the wealth. Okay. But what does he get? He gets mercy. What is mercy? Mercy means not to punish somebody who deserves to be punished. So just refraining from punishing him, that would have been mercy. Just giving him a slave job or just saying, you know, I'm not going to help you any, but I'm not going to punish you either. That would have been mercy. So the father, was that 100% the choice of the father, or was it 99% choice of the father and 1% choice of the son? No, 100% choice of the father to show him mercy. In other words, it was 100% the father's choice to refrain from punishing him when he deserved to be punished. Now, what about giving him the shoes or the ring or the robe or killing the fatted calf and throwing him a party? Those would all be grace. In other words, you're getting something you haven't merited or earned in any way, shape, or form by your actions or deeds. Okay. Has the son earned those shoes, the golden ring, the robe, the fatted calf? Did he merit those things? Not at all. But was maybe maybe a percentage of it he's responsible for? No, 100% the choice of the father to grace his son in that way. 100%. It's only when you conflate the choice of the father with the choice of the son and call them both salvation that you get this. So you take this choice over here and this choice over here, and you pull them together and you make them one big choice and you call it salvation. And you say things like, God is sovereign over salvation. And you make salvation this one big piece of pie, big pie, just one big round pie, right? Like a pie graph. And when somebody comes along, like an Arminian or provisionist or somebody else, starts talking about their responsibility and their role in the salvation and reconciliation, the bringing together of two parties, when anybody starts talking about that, they'll go, oh, okay, well, let's look at salvation. Let's look at this pie. How much of this pie is man's responsibility? How much of this pie called salvation should we sliver off and say that's what man does for his salvation? This is what man is responsible for. And this part of the pie, this 99.9%, this is God's part. And that 0.1%, that's man's part. And you're taking credit away from God for what he did. And see what you're doing? You're taking something from the pie of salvation and giving it over to man. See what they've done? They've conflated two different pies and they've made them into one pie so as to make it sound like we're trying to say salvation is not 100% of God. That is conflation, okay? God is 100% responsible for atonement. God is 100% responsible for the golden ring and the fatted calf and the shoes and the mercy, 100%. The choice of the son to humble himself and return home is 100% his responsibility. It is 100% his fault if he refuses to do it, and it is 100% his responsibility. Sin is 100% his responsibility. So I don't blame even 1% of it on God. God doesn't even tempt men to evil. I don't give 1% onto God. Whereas when you conflate all this stuff and call it sovereignty, what you end up doing is not only giving God, quote unquote, all the glory for salvation, i.e. the decision of the son to come home, but you also ultimately end up blaming God for every act of unbelief and every act of sin in all of humanity, because you have conflated two separate choices and you've made them into one, as if there's no other real will except that of the divine. And he's the one who ultimately wills what you will. And thus he becomes that pie, that one determinative pie of everything that takes place. And therefore, no one has real, true responsibility. No one has really, true the ability to respond, because God's decision is ultimately dictating what their decision is. Now, Cooper doesn't want to go that far, obviously, within the deterministic aspects of Calvinism. And I'm thankful for that. I would much rather have a Lutheran theology or Lutheran soteriology with regard to that, because that's a blessed inconsistency. It sounds like a lot like J.I. Packer, actually, where he calls it not a contradiction or a paradox. He calls it an antinomy, which if you look up the word antinomy, you will see it's a lot like paradox. It's just the concept or idea of, as paradox is defined, a seemingly absurd or self-contradictory statement or proposition that when investigated or explained may prove to be well-founded or true. So I'm assuming that what Jordan is saying is that we really can't investigate or explain this until we get to heaven. So right now we're just going to accept what seems to be absurd and self-contradictory and just know that once we get to heaven, he's going to explain how it's not. And we're just going to accept both as true. You know, in some ways I can respect that he's trying to be true to the word. I believe that he's really trying to be consistent with what he sees as quote unquote, the Calvinistic proof text and what he sees as the Arminian proof text and just say, well, I affirm that these are true and these are true. But I'm just saying that's not necessary if you don't misinterpret those proof texts that Calvinists are using to prop up things like total moral inability from birth and unconditional election being based upon even the condition of faith as not being a foundation for the reason that God chooses to mercy or grace some and not others, limits atonement. He's already in a good place there, and he's already rejected irresistible grace, at least a portion of it, I guess, how that works. And then the whole issue of perseverance and how that works, that just sounded A equals not A to me, but here, let's listen to how he closes.
A because they have chosen to reject God's grace. And if you ask a Lutheran those two questions, they're going to give different answers to both of those questions. So you say, why are some saved? We'll give the answer that the Calvinist would do, which is God's grace and God's decision and choice unconditionally. And then if you ask the second part of that question, why are others not saved? We would answer the same as the Arminians would, which is human rejection. Now, this does leave us in this sense of paradox. There's difficulty in terms of how these truths fit together. And we are very much okay leaving mystery at that point and saying, well, God's word clearly reveals both of these truths. And we don't know exactly how to fit all of the pieces together. So if you do want to learn more about the Lutheran view of this, as I said, I have a podcast on it. But I would read some materials on the issue. We actually publish Francis Pieper's Conversion and Election, which delves into this issue from a Lutheran perspective, where he deals with both the Calvinist position as well as the Arminian position. If you want to go back in history, I would recommend a book called The Call of the Gentiles or The Call to All Nations by Saint Prosper of Aquitaine. So we're
okay. And there's some recommendations. I wanted to get those in that way. If you want to study it on your own, I wanted you to hear his Jordan's recommendations so that you could do that for yourself. Like I said, you be the judge as to whether that sounds contradictory to you. It sounds most certainly contradictory to me, and I'm trying to understand how it's not. I did find this article at steadfastlutherans.org. I don't know if it's a reputable source in Jordan's estimation. Some you know, obviously, just like some Calvinists have differing views, I'm sure some Lutherans have differing views on this subject. But this is where he gets into objective justification. And I wanted to read this because really some of the things he says, again, sounds very much like a provisionist would sound. That's why I wanted to push on these things, because I think Jordan and I are probably a lot closer together on some issues than he or I are to Calvinist. Now obviously with the whole semi-Pelagian boogeyman issue, that sounds like makes it sound like we're just ages and ages apart. But the truth of the matter is, based upon what he just defined as the means of grace, I don't see how. So what is justification? For Lutherans, the central teaching of the Bible is justification by faith apart from the works of the law. Now, just take that statement in and of itself. Notice that faith is set as a contradiction to the works of the law. But yet, under the unconditional election explanation that he said earlier, is that the whole thing is not conditioned upon faith. Salvation and the choice of God is not conditioned upon faith. Okay. It is conditioned. It's unconditional in that sense. It's not conditioned upon faith, nor on works. And so instead of just saying it's not conditioned upon the works of the law, but it is conditioned upon your faith in Christ, the Lutheran goes to the same place the Calvinist does and says it's not conditioned on the works of the law or on faith. And yet the central teaching of Lutheranism is that justification is by faith apart from the works of the law. So clearly, faith is a condition for salvation, but it's not a condition for election. How does that work unless you affirm irresistible grace, which what causes you to have the condition, faith? This is why it's just mind-boggling how you can have unconditional election in the Calvinistic way of describing it, but not irresistible grace. The classic expression of this doctrine is found in Article 4 of the Augsburg Confession. Quote, also, they teach that man cannot be justified before God by their own strength, merits, or works. Okay? Does Leighton Flowers and Provisionists teach that man cannot be justified by their own strength, merits, or works? Would we affirm that? I hope you know us well enough to know that, yes, we would absolutely affirm that no one is justified before God based upon strength, merits, or works, okay? But are freely justified for Christ's sake through faith. Sounds good to me. Now, is that faith something that you're responsible for, i.e. that you're able to respond to the truth in the light of God's word? Faith cometh by hearing. Or you're able to resist it, close your eyes to it, not believe it, or to, well, that's where maybe he seems to part ways. So they're freely justified by Christ's sake through faith. When they believe that they are received into favor and their sins are forgiven for Christ's sake, who by his death has made satisfaction for our sins. So it even says when they believe that they are received into favor. Is that their responsibility, or is that something that God effectually causes? Is it something God preveniently allows for, as in the Arminian worldview? This Augsburg Confession doesn't get into that, and I'm not sure that there's any clarity here. And that their sins are forgiven for Christ's sake, who by his death has made satisfaction for our sins. This faith God imputes for righteousness in his sight. Okay, now, that's the question right here. Is this is where they're talking about, is faith a gift, effectual gift of God given to the unconditionally elected ones? And how is that not irresistible grace? How is that not what Calvinists mean by irresistible grace? Because this faith imputes for righteousness in his sight. Now, if the faith is a free response of man to trust in God, then that's great. I agree with that. It's this faith God imputes for righteousness in his sight. I would amen that, if that's what's meant by it. But it seems that it seems that Cooper says that faith is a gift from God, that God is the one who does it. But then also he says that he doesn't believe in irresistible or effectual calling or irresistible grace. So that's where it's confusion. Lutheran theologians often speak of justification as having two aspects, objective and subjective. Objective justification is, quote, God's verdict of not guilty upon the world for the sake of Jesus's life, death, and resurrection. Okay, so we've not used the terminology objective justification. I haven't. But would I agree with this concept and idea of God's verdict of not guilty upon the world for the sake of Jesus's life, death, and resurrection? Wouldn't this comport with what we see in what 1 Corinthians 5 is it? Romans 3? Talking about him passing over the sins previously committed, especially in light of what he says about subjective justification. Look what it says. Subjective justification means that the benefits of God's verdict of not guilty become yours through faith. This sounds like what we talk about when we talk about the atonement, and I talk about the serpent lifted in the desert, that the serpent is lifted up for the whole. Whoever looks to the serpent for healing will be healed, will receive the benefits. So a provision of healing is provided for the whole group through the serpent on the pole, but whoever looks to the serpent in faith receives the benefits of healing. That is a provisional atonement, or sounds like objective justification provided for the whole world, subjective applied the benefits through faith, through looking to the provision for healing. That's the heart of provision theology. This is what we're talking about. The provision is for the whole. The benefits come to those who look through faith. So this concept of what the Lutherans call objective justification, along with subjective justification, seems to fit very well with what we would call provisionism. And so that's one of the reasons I thought that Dr. Cooper and I are probably a lot closer than he may think we are, because he's worried about the semi-Pelagian boogeyman over there. So what is the basis of objective justification? This article goes on to say, Jesus has redeemed all people. John the Baptist declared, look, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. The statement which we sing in the whatever, Angus Day, I guess. I'm not familiar with a lot of the Lutheran terminology and what's that referring to. I imagine I heard that before. I'm interested. I need to have a conversation with Jordan. That's why I invited him on. I'd love to learn more here. He declares Jesus to be objective justification personified. First Paul also wrote to Timothy that Jesus, quote, gave himself as a ransom for all men, 1 Timothy 2:6, who gave himself as a ransom for all. And again, this is where we would agree, obviously, that we believe in the universal extent of the atonement. It's provided for all, only benefits those subjectively, I guess, as it would say, subjective justification to those who look. Where is objective justification taught in the Bible? 2 Corinthians 5:19, God was reconciling the world to himself in Christ, not counting men's sins against them. The only possible antecedent of there is in that sentence, the world, and the world certainly includes all men. I honestly hadn't read that far in the article, and so I referred to 2 Corinthians 5 just off the top of my head, and that was in the article. So that's kind of cool that I was thinking the same thing they were. Oh, and look, they got Romans 3 too. The righteousness of God through faith in Christ Jesus for all who believe, for there is no distinction, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God and are justified by his grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. Romans 4:25, who delivered us up from our transgressions, raised us for justification. Romans 5:18, consequently, just as the result of one trespass was condemnation for all men, so also the result of one act of righteousness was justification that brings life for all men. By raising Christ from the dead, God absolved him from our sins, which had been imputed to him, and therefore he also absolved us in him, that Christ's resurrection might thus be the case and the proof and the completion of our justification, because in Christ's resurrection we are acquitted of our sins, so that they can no longer condemn us before the judgment of God. Do the Lutheran confessions teach objective justification? While the term objective justification does not appear in the Lutheran confessions, the teaching of objective justification may be found there. The Apology of the Augsburg Confession teaches that a refusal to believe that our sins are forgiven by God is to call God a liar. And what else is the refusal to assent to the absolution but charging God with falsehood? If the heart doubts, it regards those things which God promises as uncertain and of no account. Accordingly, 1 John 5 and 10, it is written, he that believeth not hath made him a liar, because he believeth not in the record that God gave of his Son. Therefore, if any one be not confident that he is forgiven, he denies that God has sworn what is true. That which is more horribly blasphemy cannot be imagined. The larger catechism teaches us our sins are forgiven prior to our acceptance of forgiveness. Therefore, and this is where I would start possibly stepping off the Lutheran boat of objective justification, because it seems to be the benefit is being applied already prior to us in faith asking for forgiveness. In other words, I would say that the provision of forgiveness or the provision of healing is provided, but forgiveness doesn't truly take place until after confession, where this seems to be saying that the forgiveness has already taken place prior to confession. And that would be kind of like saying that the healing has taken place prior to looking to the serpent. It seems like the order would be that you look to the serpent so as to be healed, just as you look to Christ for healing so as to have forgiveness and such. And again, I am openly confessing, as even Cooper did, Dr. Cooper confessed his lack of knowledge of provisionism when he started his video. And I started my video in much the same way. I don't know Lutheranism very well, and I admit that up front. But that's why I'm presenting it. I'm letting him speak for himself. I played the entire video there for you. It's in the show notes as well, and read from at least one reputable argument or article supporting the Lutheran perspective. Coleman is, Dr. Flowers, provisionism is new to me. Could you please explain the relationship between provisionism and Arminianism? Also, would you identify as Arminian? Why or why not? I do have an article. If you type in just the word Arminian at Soteriology 101, you would find several articles where I go back and forth with some respectable Arminians. I have a lot of respect for Dr. Brian Abishano, who is the president of the Society for Evangelical Arminians. I've had him on the program before. I agree with much of what he says. and agree with a lot of his commentary on Romans 9 and a lot of the same things we would argue together and agree with each other on a lot of things. But I go in those articles a little bit more in depth as to why I would not consider myself an Arminian and why I don't think Brian Albashano would be comfortable calling me an Arminian. Namely, one is that I don't affirm total inability, the concept of that we are born in a moral incapacitated state to respond to the grace of God, which comes through the gospel. I believe that mankind maintains that ability because God's gracious enough to allow us to maintain as image bearers of him, the ability to respond to him. And so I don't think he's going to send a message that's insufficient, calling lost people to be reconciled from their lost condition. I think he's going to send a sufficient message, a sufficiently gracious message, a sufficiently enabling message, if you will. And so if you want to say prevenient grace must mean there's some kind of ontological change within the nature of a man in order to reestablish a lost ability to respond to God, it sounds like baggage added to the text. I don't think there's any reason to say something like that unless you believe everybody's born already blind and deaf. And as I've already explained it earlier in the program, I don't think there's any basis for holding to that perspective. I think you can become hardened. You can lose your moral ability to see and hear, but that's not something you're born with. You're not born with that incapacity. So that's one major area of difference with Arminians. Also, Arminians differ on perseverance or the P of TULIP. Most classical Arminians do believe that you can leave your salvation or that you can refuse faith in God anymore. And so if you can leave your faith and therefore leave justification behind, you can once be redeemed and then lose salvation, or you can be indwelled by the Spirit, but then the Spirit would abandon you because you left the faith. Whereas provisionist or traditional Southern Baptist would typically argue the opposite of that's what predestination is really all about, is that God is destined beforehand. That's what predestination means for us, is that a destination has been set beforehand. And so the destination set beforehand is for those who are in Christ Jesus. So if you put your faith in Christ, the chosen one, then he's the federal head. He's the one who covers us. So if you have faith in him, then you're covered by him and you're in him. And if he seals you in him, if he indwells you, then he is faithful to bring you to salvation. And so, either eternal life begins at the time of glorification upon your death, physical death here on earth, or it begins at the time of your rebirth as a regenerate man. And provisionists teach that it starts at the time of your rebirth. In other words, there is a point of regeneration, and that point of regeneration is what seals you, true believers, in him, so that they will certainly be brought to sanctification and glorification. Whereas the typical classical Arminian perspective is ultimately saying that people all the way up to their death can actually abandon the faith. They can walk away and lose what they once had, lose the salvation that they once had. So that's one of the reasons, two of the reasons, I guess, that I would not be considered a classical Arminian is because of my denial of total inability, total moral inability from birth, and my denial of the concept or idea that you can once be regenerated and then lose that salvation, lose your salvation. Do you think his confused position sounds like a mix of early and late Augustine? Maybe that the cause of the confused position definitely sounds Augustinian. Yeah, I mean, I think a lot of the Westernized formulations, I mean, Luther was obviously very reliant upon Augustine by his own admission. R.C. Sproul talks about that with John Calvin and Luther both referencing Augustine more than anybody else in their resources. And so if Augustine was wrong, as we suppose that he was in the debates with the Manichaeans, post-conversion, and his debate later with Pelagius, we believe that he made some fundamental errors. Now, I think it's probably more accurate to call me a semi-Augustinian, as does some of the scholars Paul Cooper. I keep calling Paul Cooper because I have a friend named Paul Cooper who's been on the program before, but this is Jordan Cooper, so I keep using the wrong names. But Dr. Cooper referenced a couple of scholars, and I've looked at a couple of scholars, their books, And some of them are actually making some of the same points that I'm making in this regard, and that we would better be described as semi-Augustinian because we outright reject the heretical aspects that were deemed as heretical in the councils that they often reference as authorities. Now, we don't reference those Catholic councils as authority as Southern Baptist, obviously, because we don't believe in infant baptism for regeneration, for example. We as Southern Baptists would reject that. So there's no reason that we would appeal to councils that obviously would undermine a lot of our other foundational beliefs as Southern Baptists. And so, people can appeal to Orange or Second Orange or Dort or all these Catholic councils all they want. We as Southern Baptists don't appeal to Catholic councils for our authority. We actually affirm sola scriptura in that sense. We appeal to Scripture as our authority. And that's what I would love to see more of, instead of the whole boogeyman labeling, hey, you're a semi-Manichaean, or you're a semi-Gnostic, or you're a semi-Catholic, or you're a semi-Pelagian, or whatever another label we want to slap on each other. Hey, let's go to the Bible. How about that? Let's look at where it says that these things were written so that you may believe. And maybe you can find at least one verse that says you can't believe what you may believe. Let's find one verse that says you can't believe the Holy Spirit wrought truth of God's word, the double-edged sword that pierces not through bone and marrow, but through soul and spirit. Let's talk about that for a while. How about it? Let's go to Acts 28, verses 23 through 28, and establish how you can maintain that people are born ever seeing, never perceiving, when Paul clearly and unequivocally says that is a condition from those who have grown calloused and have shut their eyes, and even tells us what they might have done otherwise, and even can contrast them with Gentiles who will listen. Let's go there. Let's go through dozens of other passages that we've read 1,001 times, which doesn't support the concept of pre-faith regeneration, but clearly indicates that we're not made alive so as to believe, but that instead it's through faith that we're made alive. Let's talk about all those Bible verses. I welcome the exegetical debate over these particular issues instead of a punting to a fifth century boogeyman label, which is actually not introduced until 1577 by Beza. So, that's where I would like to see our discussion go. Unfortunately, it gets bogged down in a bunch of other stuff. Says, I don't think it's a badge of honor to call yourself a Southern Baptist, especially with increasing liberalism in their ranks. Well, you may be right, but that's what I am. I am a Southern Baptist, and I hold to a lot of the doctrines that have been consistently Southern Baptist. In any group, Lutheran included, have liberal wings. And if you think otherwise, then you've just got your head in the sand, because I cannot think of a theological group out there that doesn't have a liberal wing attached to it. So I'm not sure that that's a really good argument. I've heard Dr. Allen say that John Calvin doesn't believe in the doctrine of limited atonement. Do you think the L is the easiest point of the TULIP to refute? Yes. I mean, even Cooper, Dr. Cooper is mentioning there, obviously, that it's very, very easy to refute. As Dr. Allen, I think, argues quite regularly, is limited atonement is a doctrine in view of a text, in search of a text. There's just no scripture passage that says that Jesus laid down his life only for the unconditionally chosen or the elect, and nothing of that sort. The closest they have is using the negative inference fallacy when it talks about him laying his life down for the church or for the sheep or these kinds of things, but that doesn't exclude the fact that he lays down his life for the world. Just because it's true of the part doesn't mean it's true of the whole, not true of the whole, which is just the negative inference fallacy. It's like when Paul says, Christ laid down his life for me. Applying the negative inference fallacy, if we're going to take that verse out of its context and not look at the whole of Scripture, then we could say, oh, well, look, Jesus only laid down his life for Paul, so only Paul can be saved. And that's an extreme version, but that's exactly what they're doing with those verses when they pull them out of context and say, Jesus laid down his life for the church, therefore he didn't lay down his life for anybody else, and therefore nobody else can enter the church. It's really bad logic, and doesn't have a lot of ground to stand on, which is one of the reasons I think you see Arminianism or four-point Calvinism on the rise. Calvinism kind of resurged up, and a lot of people are leaving the L behind. And it won't be long, in my estimation, that they'll start leaving other points of Calvinism behind, because historically that's what's happened. Calvinism resurges and dies back out because either because God ordained it to, or because it doesn't hold water. I think it's the latter. I'm looking through side chat here. If you're wondering why I just get quiet all of a sudden, because I don't have anybody else talking, and so I just have to look at the side chat and read while I'm looking for your comments here. Okay. Was the semi-Pelagian sources that he posted reputable? Were you going to go through those to show how they don't represent provisionist views? I don't have them in front of me, but I don't mind going through some of those because I was actually reading a couple of them. And the last video I did on semi-Pelagianism, I actually played a clip from Dr. Cooper, where he refers to a couple books, and then he even comes out and says, now he even admits, he calls it semi-Pelagian, but he even admits that this is not the best label because it's polemical. It's attached to a known heretic. And in two of the sources, I looked up to the sources that he first referenced to me, they both said that they think the term semi-Augustinian would be more accurate historically than semi-Pelagianism, because even the semi-Pelagians that he's accusing of being semi-Pelagian rejected the heretical aspects of what was condemned in semi-Pelagianism even. And so they're even making the same case that we don't believe what most scholars define as being the central theme of what semi-Pelagianism is. And that is that man takes the first step towards God, that man is the initiator. I can't tell you how many times we have said that we are responders. We are never the initiators in any aspect of it. We are responders. We are the ones who respond to the grace of God. We are the one that runs. The question is, what is that grace? And for the typical westernized view of this whole debate within the highly evolved Augustinian tradition is that grace is some kind of a supernatural work of regeneration. It's either partial regeneration on Arminianism, or it's full-blown effectual regeneration on Calvinism. And it's, I guess, objective justification on Lutheranism. I'm not sure what they would replace it with, because obviously it's not either one of those. So I just reject the categories of it. Just like Lutherans don't like to be labeled by the categories of the debate between Arminians and Calvinists, provisionist traditional Southern Baptists, we don't either. We don't want to be limited by the categories that have marked this historical debate, because we're rejecting the premise for which the debate even occurs. There wouldn't be a debate if not for the concept of total inability. If you just take away total inability and you give back human responsibility, in other words, people are born, yes, sinful, fallen, corrupt, bondage to sin, slaves to sin, dead, meaning separated from God because of their rebellion. Give all of that's true, okay? But you still maintain the ability of the lost person to respond to God's life-giving truth. If you just give that, the debate just goes, shoo, it's gone. Not a problem anymore. Why? Because what is God doing? He's bringing grace through the gospel, calling people to respond to him. They're responsible, able to respond to his light, his truth. They accept it or they reject it. And they suffer the consequences if they reject it. They reap the harvest if they accept it. Then that's it. And then we can debate over perseverance as to whether it, once we accept it, whether the act of regeneration or the work of regeneration when he comes into our heart, if that's effectual or not, or if that's something that's going to work itself out to the end in the kind of the once saved, always saved, or if saved, always saved, I think is probably a better way of putting it. Tradition of Southern Baptist, that can be debated still, I guess, but everything else is just gone. The first 4 points of Calvinism is just, it's gone. You don't need it anymore. If you just simply accept that people have responsibility from birth, meaning the ability to respond to God's light, to God's grace, to God's truth from birth, the first TULI, gone. You don't even need them. It's really simple. That's why I focus so much on the T and why I get the whole semi-Pelagian boogeyman on me all the time, because people are just so scared that I'm stepping into a heresy. Oh, heaven forbid. I believe that God graciously maintained our ability to respond to him versus giving it all back to us at some later point in life that the Bible never talks about. I mean, why that's so heretical? Why that's just such a gasp of, oh my goodness. It's not like I'm saying we're out there building in our tool shed free wills. Okay. This is a grace by God's giving. Okay. He's the one who made us as image bearers, responders. He's the one who's given us the ability to do what we do. If you want to call it a common grace or whatever, that's just one of the reasons I'm going back and forth. And they were saying, oh, so you believe that by nature we can just respond to God? But what is nature? What is man's nature if not what God created? Okay. How did God make us? Did God make us as responsible responders? Or did he make us as corpse-like, dead, completely morally unable, incapable people because of something our greatest grandfather did? Okay. The Bible doesn't seem to indicate to me that the fall causes fallen people not to be able to respond to his appeals to be reconciled from the fall. Silly me. I think the appeal to be reconciled from the fall is probably sufficient to allow for a fallen person to respond to it. And that's why they're held responsible for it. That's why Jesus says in John chapter 12 that I don't judge you. The very words that I speak to you will judge you on the final day. In other words, you're not judged by Adam's sin. You're not judged by how many times you break the commandments of God. What are you judged by? You're judged by the very words of God, which Jesus says are spirit and life. My very words, the very words that I've spoken to you, he says in John chapter 6, are spirit and life. Why wouldn't I believe that they are spirit and life if he says they are? Why would I believe that they're not sufficient to do what the Bible says they were meant to do? Why wouldn't I believe what Hebrews says about the words of God as being sharper than a double-edged sword and cutting inwardly? This is another big debate we keep getting back and forth into, is like trying to say, oh, well, we believe in an inner working, an inward working of grace, and you just believe in some external stuff. Wrong. I'm sorry. I think truth impacts us internally. I think the word of God impacts us internally. Why even my words to you, and I illustrated this in a conversation I had with a Calvinist friend of mine named Sean. Y'all may have remembered this conversation, is we're talking to each other about this, and he's just not getting it. It's just not sinking in with him. He's saying, you keep thinking that it's just about information, and you just think it's external. And I'm talking about God working inwardly, this internal grace of God. That's what Sean was saying. He's this internal grace of God, this effectual work of internal grace. And you just believe in external stuff. And I just looked at Sean. I said, Sean, man, you offended me, man. I am so mad at you. And you guys know me. I'm always really nice to the people who Augustinian. Hey, you making fun of my Texas accent, Andrew? And well, you gave me money, so it's okay. For $2, you can make fun of all the ways I mispronounce words. So, like when I used to say reprobate instead of reprobate. Or there's been several others that I've mispronounced for a long time, and that I realized that I'm mispronouncing them after people pointed out. So yeah, you're welcome to make fun of my words. But I was talking to Sean Cole, Calvinist guy. And he's saying, no, you just believe in this external work of grace, this external stuff. I'm talking about inward work. And you guys know me, I'm really cool with people. I'm nice to people. I like to keep things pretty casual and not yelling at each other, all those kinds of things. And all of a sudden, man, I get mad at him. And I just like get red faced. And I'm just, you made me so mad. I cannot believe you said this, Sean. And he's going, what did I do? Like, no, I'm sorry. What did I say? And he's just like all backing off and saying, man, what did I do? I'm sorry, man. I didn't mean to offend you. And I'm just acting like I'm really mad. And then I just stopped and I smiled at him. I said, I'm just joking. I was trying to prove something to you. And then I said, were you impacted internally just now? Is your heart racing right now? He's like, oh yeah, yeah. Okay. That's just little old Leighton. My external words just impacted you so much so that you apologized. Your heart started racing. You started sweating. I had that much little old Leighton, just with my silly little bitty words of getting mad at you and saying those things, I had that much internal impact on you. And you're telling me that the inspired words of God don't have an internal impact on those who hear those words? Why in the world not? How in the world can my words that I type to you on a Twitter possibly convict you or change your perspective to become a provisionist. And there are a lot of people becoming provisionists. We hear about them all the time, people who are adopting our worldview. How can little old Leighton convince people to become provisionists online through podcasts and through these things? But God inspires a book to be written, and he can't convince people to become Christians through the truth and the persuasion of his divine truth and word? Why not? People, listen, the Quran can convince somebody to fly an airplane into a building in order to get 72 virgins, but the Bible can't convince people to believe that Jesus is the Son of God and that he died for our sins. Why not? The history book can convince me that George Washington was the first president of the United States, but it can't convince me that Jesus Christ claimed to be the Son of God and died on the cross. Why not? Since when does truth have to be magically infused with some kind of something in order for us to believe truth? The reason people don't believe truth is if they choose to suppress it. If they, as Paul said, trade it in for lies. You can't trade something you don't have in. You have to have it in order to trade it, okay? That's what Paul says. They trade the truth of God in for lies. That means they had the truth of God. That means they had what they needed in order to believe and know that God is real, that he's there. And if they trade that in, whose fault is that? Is that a lacking of God's provision, a lacking of God's grace, a lacking of something that God just didn't provide for them? God didn't send Jesus to atone for them. And at least Jordan doesn't make that mistake, as the Calvinists make, by trying to put it ultimately back onto God for not really choosing them or providing them with grace. He may be inconsistent, but it's a blessed inconsistency, because at least he's maintaining the universal love and desire and provision of God for all to be saved. And I can amen that. Amen you for that, Lutherans. At least you're maintaining, I think, something that's absolutely essential to understand the character and the goodness and the nature of our God. Now, yeah, you're confounding and you're confusing in your process of doing that. But nevertheless, thank God for that blessed inconsistency. Pat says it turns the power of the truthful and powerful word of God into a powerless and feeble scribble. Well put. I mean, this is the baffling thing about it, is that they accuse me of saying, well, the Bible, you're just making the Bible, the gospel, just mere information. And I'm saying, guys, I'm doing just the opposite of that. You, especially Calvinists, you're the ones who are making it mere information. It's mere information to inform the elect people of what God's already done for them. That's mere information. I'm saying that the gospel is God's grace. It's the power of God to enlighten us, to help us to see the truth, to know that we are sinners and we are in need of a Savior, calling us by making an appeal, be reconciled to God, that Christ in us making his appeal, be reconciled to God. That is light. That is revelation. That is truth. That is mercy. That is grace. That is power. On your view, Calvinist, it's just mere information. You're merely informing the elect of what regeneration, which is the real power of God, this pre-faith regeneration, that's the real power of God unto salvation, because it's what changes your nature and it changes your heart. So gospel for Calvinists is mere information informing the already regenerate of what God's already done for them. The gospel is the power of God unto salvation on provisionism. And so we're the ones who are saying that God is the one who works through his gospel, through his truth, to make an appeal, to invite us, to call us to salvation. So the irony of saying that we're the ones who are making the gospel mere information is just, it's baffling to me, because we're the ones who are speaking out, like Pat's saying there, saying it's not just mere information. It's not just mere scribbling. It's not mere just text on a page. It's inspired truth meant to impact us internally, because it is from God. And especially since we're created as in his image, we're looking for this truth. We're longing for truth. We need this truth. Okay, so I'm being accused of lying. So Leighton can lie about Lutheranism as much as he wants in here, right? I mean, I played the entire clip of a Lutheran explaining what he views. Now, you can accuse me of misunderstanding something he said. I put the article on the screen from a Lutheran source and read it about what objective justification is. I'm not intentionally, quote unquote, lying. Lying implies intention. Like I am purposefully trying to deceive my audience to think that Lutherans believe something that they don't believe. I think the best you can say is Leighton is confused, and therefore he's misinforming his audience about what he thinks Lutheranism is, because it's not really that. And that I would say maybe that's true, but I'm inviting a Lutheran scholar to come on and explain it to us. I've invited him several times to come on, and I'll continue to do so. It's not a lack of desire on my part to hear and learn for more of what Lutherans say. And so accusing people of lying is not really helpful, brother. So let's not do that. That's a good question. Aaron's pointing out, can you reference the passage of scripture where God says that some people are not given the gift of faith? Because this is the problem. It's one thing to say that faith is a gift from God, in that faith cometh by hearing, and hearing the word of God. In other words, God brings the truth by which you can believe. You can't believe without the truth. How will they believe in one who they have not heard? So God grants faith and repentance by bringing the message of faith and repentance, but you're still responsible for what you do with it. So we just don't believe that that a gift has to be irresistibly or effectually given for the giver to get full credit for giving it. So we're fine if you want to reference faith as a gift in that respect. It's a common grace of God brought for all people. It's an ability that God's given all people to put trust in him and to trust him as their Lord. That a gift in that sense is fine. But if you mean that faith is an effectual gift given to some people and withheld from all others, then we would just have to say, as I think Jordan Cooper would say, where is that in the Bible? And that's one thing I appreciate about Jordan Cooper's perspective as a Lutheran, is that he's trying to say, not ever to say anything that the Bible doesn't say, whereas the Calvinists are going to just adopt the full system, full board, regardless, and they're going to be consistent logically, though not scripturally, whereas at least the Lutheran is trying to be as biblical as possible, even if it makes himself seem completely contradictory. And I would just point back and say, take a couple of steps and you're in the provisionist camp, and you don't have to just by adopting the concept and idea that we're still responsible creatures as fallen creatures, you can get rid of all that other contradictory stuff. And it's really not much. You don't have to go very far, Dr. Cooper, in order to be in the same camp as we are with regard to provisionism. Now, there's probably some more stuff there with regard to sacramental stuff that I'm not even aware of, and what you believe and how you teach with regard to those things. Because obviously when it comes to baptism, Lord's Supper, and other sacramental kinds of things, we as Baptists hold to a little different, obviously, theology and perspective than what possibly Lutherans hold to, especially if there's baptismal regeneration of infants, no doubt. I mean, that's to me a very, very hard sell. Okay, Sam is saying, I see the point you're trying to make, but you're still basically equating the work of the Holy Spirit with some sort of internal feeling, which is super unconvincing. Maybe, Sam, are you talking to somebody else, or are you talking to me? Okay. Maybe Sam's talking to somebody else and I'm not following, because I'm not arguing that the Holy Spirit, equating the work of the Holy Spirit with some internal feeling. Okay. I'm following your argument now, Sam. Okay. What you're talking about my illustration with Sean, because he had an internal feeling. He felt embarrassed, or he felt shamed, or he felt whatever, fearful that he was offending me or whatever else. And I'm equating what the Holy Spirit does with that internal feeling, which is super unconvincing to you. Okay. I'm following you now, Sam. All right, good. All right. So I'm giving an analogy. Obviously I don't think that there's a one-to-one ratio between the feelings of Sean Cole and what I'm saying. What I'm trying to establish is that even my words, which are not supernatural and inspired, can have an impact on him internally, can affect him internally, and can even persuade him to believe something I believe. Okay. History books can do that. Quran can do that. Other false religions and worldviews can do that. Even basic human truth, like the president of the United States, who he is, whatever. You can believe truth statements. You can also believe false statements. You can believe things. And so what I'm trying to say is, okay, so it's your burden to prove that for some reason God decreed for his truth, the truth he revealed to mankind through inspiration, is unbelievable. It can't be believed unless previously there's some kind of inworking of supernatural something which does something that's never really defined. We're not sure what it is, but it does something to the nature of man, whether it's giving them a new heart, regenerating them, making them alive. I mean, all the different kinds of vernacular that's used, or in the Arminian camp, partially doing that to them to bring them to a neutral state of some sort. I don't know. That's the stuff we're looking for in the scriptures. Okay, where does the Bible say this is what has to happen in order for people to believe the truth of God? They can believe the Quran, they can believe the history books, they can believe this, this, and this, but they just can't believe the Bible. Okay, why not? Why can't they believe the Bible? And if it's because of sin and the fall, then you have to ask, okay, well, why did sin and the fall cause people to be incapable of hearing and believing the appeal of God to be reconciled from that fall? And the only answer that is possible from an Arminian or a Calvinist perspective is because God decided that would happen. In other words, God decided in his plan that the fall would make people incapable of reconciling with him, even when he invited them to. And it's like, what would be the point in that? Why not just send a message that's sufficient to be believed? If there was a clear passage of scripture that just came right out and said, there must be this quote unquote prevenient work of grace or this effectual work of grace, whatever it is, in order for somebody to believe the gospel, then yeah, I'd be right there with you. But if it's not there, I mean, I have to be true to the word, and I just don't see anything there. I don't see that taught anywhere. And that's what I'm asking for. And I don't care if you call me a Pelagian or a semi-Pelagian. I'm going to go back to the scripture and I'm going to say, okay, where does the Bible say this? If it doesn't say it, then I can't believe it. I'm willing to learn. I'm willing to see. I'm willing to understand these things. If you want to show me where the Bible says this stuff, then I'll be the first to sign off. But the verses that are usually brought up are very obscure kind of texts that can be taken in four different ways, and most certainly don't necessitate this moral incapacity from birth that God decreed, that we're born in a condition where we can't even respond to him. I mean, I just don't see it. James talking to Andy says, the gospel is the power of God, and he's able to save any and all who believe in Jesus Christ, death, burial, and resurrection. All who call upon the name of the Lord will be saved. Amen. Aaron is confronting Tony as well, I guess, saying, Tony, you're wrong conflating following God's will in living out your life in an ongoing basis in his will with the one-time belief. Totally two different things. That oftentimes happens in these discussions where there's a conflation between the two different aspects of our salvation, whether sanctification or justification. I'm just looking inside chat to see if there's any more last questions before I close here, because I've got to run. Getting close to the 2-hour mark here, so that's pretty short for me though. That's a good verse to end on right here. Hazleton Baptist Mission. For I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth. First to the Jew, and then to the Greek. So whenever it says, we praise God because he has granted repentance even to the Gentiles unto life. Acts 11, I believe it is. Could be wrong on that. What do we mean by that? Does that mean he effectually causes some people to believe from the Gentile nations? Or does it mean that he brought the message, the power of God and salvation, so that they may believe? See, this is what we mean by grant. Grant and enable means to grant and enable. It doesn't mean to effectually cause. And I guess the Lutherans would probably agree with that because they deny irresistible grace. So to grant or to enable something means to grant or enable, to allow for, to permit it, okay? You can't come to a party unless you've been permitted. You can't come to the party unless you've been invited, right? You can't believe in somebody you haven't heard of. You have to have that first. You have to have light. You have to have truth in order to know your way out of darkness, okay? So we need the light. We need that, all right? That's the power of God into salvation. It's the light of the gospel. If the light of the gospel is made abundantly clear, the truth of who he is made abundantly clear, then you're responsible for that light. You're responsible to it. And therefore, we can say God's granted salvation first to the Jew by bringing them the message of salvation, the message and means by which they may be saved. And he brought it to the Gentile, thus granting them the ability to believe and be saved. and thus all are responsible, all are without excuse. No one can say, God didn't send me a light. God didn't send me truth. God didn't send me sufficient light. God didn't send me sufficient truth, which many people ask, well, what about those who haven't heard the specifics of the news of Jesus Christ? I don't have enough time to answer that question, but you can go to Sociology 101. And there is an article. If you just type in, what about those who've never heard, or just the word never heard, and it'll come up, the very first one, and read that article, and gives you some indication of what we believe with regard to the light of general revelation versus special revelation. It's also in this book, God's Provision for All, a couple chapters that covered that very question, along with several other questions about God's provision. Calvinism is not even mentioned in the bulk of this book. It is a positive presentation from the scriptures as to what it means to believe in God's provision and love for all people. And so I highly recommend that. If you haven't got it, pick it up at Amazon. So love you guys. God bless you. See you next time. Be good.